टुडेज टॉपिक इज माइक्रो प्रोपेगेशन एंड हैंडलिंग ऑफ अ प्लांट इन अ नर्सरी. माइक्रो प्रोपेगेशन दैट मीन्स द रेफर्स ऑफ रेफर्स टू द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ प्लांट फ्रॉम वेरी स्मॉल प्लांट पार्ट टिश्यू सेल ग्रोन असेप्टिकली इन अ टेस्ट ट्यूब और कंटेनर अंडर कंट्रोल न्यूट्रिशनल एनवायरमेंट एंड असेप्टिक कंडीशन इज कॉल्ड एज माइक्रो प्रोपेगेशन. ओके, through the micropropagation we can use only a single cell or a plant tissue for growing a new plant in aseptic condition, that is in control condition. All the biological principles of micropropagation techniques are based on the phenomenon of totipotency of cell, which implies that the plant cell has the capacity to generate into a full-fledged plant having different organs. Okay, so the micropropagation principle of micropropagation technique is based on totipotency. Totipotency of cell, that means a single cell can produce a whole plant. It is called as totipotency. So the micropropagation is based on totipotency. Micropropagation versus other propagation methods as like sexual propagation, asexual propagation. Micropropagation is also a sexual propagation, but it is this practice is carried out in lab condition, total controlled condition, aseptic condition. And other vegetative propagation, that means the budding, grafting, cutting, that are carried out in open condition or semi-open condition like a poly house or a shade net, etc. Micropropagation differs from other vegetative propagation as a very small plant part, that is egg plant, is used as a starting material. The plants are maintained in a small container having well-defined culture medium. Highly aseptic conditions are required and a large propagating material is produced a very short time. So this is the advantages of micropropagation. Through micropropagation, we can produce a large number of plants in a very short period. And the planting material required very small parts of plant required as a planting material. The various application of micropropagation are rapid rate of multiplication of plants, cloning, production of disease-free and disease-resistant plants, production of mutant and selection of mutant, production of haploids through anthraculture, then wide hybridization through excised embryo or ovule culture, somatic hybrid and cybrid through protoplast fusion, transformation through uptake of foreign genome, nitrogen fixation and cryopreservation of germplasm. This is the various application of micropropagation. Through the micropropagation, we can produce number of plants within a very short period, that is a rapid rate of multiplication. Through the micropropagation, we can produce a disease-free or virus-free plant through resistant plants through the meristem, using a meristem portion of the plant, then induction of mutant and selection of mutant. Through the micropropagation, we can also produce a haploid plant through anthraculture. And hybridization through excised embryo and ovule culture. So this is the application of micropropagation. Some advantages of micropropagation: propagation of large propagating material in a short time, production of disease-free plants, then clonal propagation of parental stock for hybrid seed production, year-round nursery production, useful in a propagating of dioecious plants, then breeding cycle is reduced, useful in hard propagate plant species and germplasm preservation. So this is the advantages. Through micropropagation, we can reduce the breeding cycle, Then this is useful in propagation of dioecious plants. Dioecious means male and female flower present on different plants. Okay. Then disadvantages, some disadvantages of micropropagation. Expensive and sophisticated facilities, trained personnel and specialized techniques are required. For this method, we have to require some sophisticated facilities like some machineries, then trained labor or technical skill required. Then high cost of production results for expensive facilities and high labor inputs. For the micropropagation, we have to require well-protected or well-established lab. And this is a very high cost. Then contamination or infestation can cause high losses in short time. This is the main disadvantages of micropropagation. If the contamination or the insect infestation can be caused, then that can cause high losses in a very short time. Higher level of somatic variation, poor establishment of plantlets in the field. Sometimes the plants cannot be adapted into the new environment, open field environment. So some failure may be occur on that time. Then principle and practice of micropropagation. First is the totipotency and plant regeneration. The term totipotency was coined by German plant physiologist Haberland in 1902. Okay, so the totipotency term is coined by Haberland in 1902. This is achieved by excising the plant explants and placing it on culture medium, which involves the following consecutive events. For the micropropagation, the culture medium is very important for the propagation of plants. If the explants are placing into the culture medium, some steps or the some consecutive events we will see in the following points. Differentiation of source tissue or organ, as a result of which the physiological mechanism activate in the cell, which leads to the cell division. Okay, so the after placing of explants into the culture medium, first is the leads to cell division, then activate the cell division into the entire explant, results in the proliferation of callus tissue. Proliferation means producing a new organs or roots, etc. Okay, then organization of proliferation, that means the multiplication of different plants. Okay, then organization of defined meristem results in the formation of shoot, root, and meristem or both. Regeneration and differentiation of new organs through organogenesis or somatic embryogenesis. So this is the terms we will see in the next point. Auxiliary bud proliferation. It is considered as a convenient route of micropropagation because it does not include a callus stage and is considered safe for the preservation of clonal characteristics. It has been observed that many workers that large number of auxiliary shoots buds grow extensively when shoot tips or even smaller apical meristems are cultured in an appropriate culture medium containing higher concentration of cytokinin. Okay, so in open field condition, and the role of cytokinin and auxins are, the auxin produce shoots and cytokinin produce root. But in micropropagation or in a lab condition, cytokinin, role of cytokinin is to produce a shoot and auxins is to produce a root. Both the excision of the plants and the cytokinin-rich medium activate the bud, leading to the proliferation of many side shoots, which can later separate for further culture. After the proliferation of many side shoots, which can later separate for a further culture. Then the separated part can be used for the next use for the multiplication of plants. Organogenesis, development of organ. Organogenesis, that means a development of organ. Organogenesis from X plant results in the formation of both shoots and roots. These are the organ of plant, root and shoots. Generally, shoots are formed first than the root. Okay. In field condition, first the plants produce root and then after shoots. But in lab condition, plants produce first shoot and then after root. The regeneration of other organ occurs later on, either in the same media or after subculturing in the another media, supplemented with different concentration of salt under the different environmental condition. For in the lab condition, the culture medium is also different as compared to the field condition. Concentration of salt under the different environmental condition, different concentration. Then somatic embryogenesis. Somatic embryogenesis is a different from organogenesis in that regeneration and organization are bipolar, that is the shoot and root meristem. The X plants are formed simultaneously from pre-embryonic masses. Okay. In the first point, organogenesis, we have seen the plant produce first shoot and then after root. But in somatic embryogenesis, the plant produce simultaneously shoot and root. Differentiation and organization of somatic embryogenesis, usually two-stage culture is involved. First, induction of pre-embryonic masses, which usually favored by 2,4-D or other auxins. And second, transfer of the pre-embryonic masses to the differentiation medium, which in which the somatic embryos fully differentiated into the organ. Then stages of micropropagation. Micropropagation is an integrated process in which cell, tissue, organ of the selected plants are isolated, surface sterilized and incubated in the growth promoting sterile medium and environment to the produce a large number of plants. Okay, so this is the micropropagation. The different stages of micropropagation. First stage is the selection of mother plant for explant isolation. Okay, explant isolation, that means the take a small cell or a meristem from the mother plant for producing a new plant. The mother plant from which explant has to be excised should be a certified and true. This is the criteria of selection of mother plant. A certified or true type of representative of desired species and cultivar, healthy from free from diseases and insect. Then it should be quite vigorous. Okay, so first selection of mother plant for explant isolation. Next stage is the explant establishment in a culture medium. Then during this stage, the explant is a culture in a suitable culture medium, preferably agar based media for tissue activation and multiplication. So for the multiplication of a plants or establishment of explant. Okay, so for this stage we have to use a media, and for the tissue activation we have to use agar media for multiplication of plants. Then proliferation and multiplication. In this stage, repeated subculturing is done to encourage more proliferation, which largely depends upon the combination of growth regulators The duration of this stage is unlimited and largely depends upon the choice of propagator. In this stage, proliferation and multiplication, the culture is repeated. Subculturing, in this stage, repeated subculturing is done to encourage the more proliferation. Okay, that means the more multiplication of plants. This is largely depends upon the combination of growth regulators. Okay, so the growth regulators, role of growth regulators in lab is also very important. And then the duration of the stage is unlimited and largely depends upon the choice of propagator. Then third number stage is the plant establishment and rooting. In this stage, the selected plants are forced to force for root formation, which can be achieved by the media modification and modifying the concentration of growth regulators. The concentration of cytokinin and sugars are reduced, the concentration of auxins and light intensity in the laboratory is increased to start with photosynthesis and other physiological activities. Okay, so this is the stage to establishment of rooting into the plant. Okay, for this purpose, we have to modify the media with the help of concentration of root growth regulators. In the concentration of cytokinin and sugar is reduced, and the concentration of auxins and light intensity is increased, that start the photosynthesis. Okay, so for the rooting of the plants, we have to reduce the concentration of cytokinin and sugar. Then acclimatization or hardening. Fourth number stage, hardening or acclimatization. The plantlets develop into the culture tube are acclimatized to specific environment having a high humidity, a low light level and a constant temperature. Besides, the root develop into in a vitro are hairless and hence delicate, requiring care during the transfer from the culture medium. To have better survival rate, and plantlets may be transferred to a container kept in the mist chamber where relative humidity is maintained at higher order. Once new growth is seen, the plants may be slowly transferred to outside by exposing to increase a light intensity in a stage. Okay, so the hardening or acclimatization, that means the plant accept a new environment, that is called as hardening, acclimatization. Okay, the plantlets develop in the culture tubes and are acclimatized to a specific environment having high humidity and low light intensity, a constant temperature. Besides, root develop into the in vitro are hairless and hence delicate. So, requiring a care during the transfer from culture medium. For the better survival rate, plantlets may be transferred to a container kept in a mist chamber where the relative humidity is maintained at higher order. And once the growth is seen, the plants may be slowly transferred to outside by exposing. That means the plants develop in a laboratory. The condition is humidity is high and light intensity is and the temperature is constant. But in the other open field environment or the mist chamber, that means the protected structure like a poly house or mostly poly house. In that condition, the temperature as compared to the lab condition is high and humidity is low. So the plant transfer to that condition. If the plants are adapt or the acclimatized that condition, temperature or humidity, after that the plants can be transferred to the main field. Okay. Once the plantlets are well rooted, they must acclimatize to the greenhouse environment. So second stage is the first stage is lab condition. Then the plant is transferred to the polyhouse condition. Okay. Then if the roots are formed that the plant then plant of that plants, then the plants are transferred to the greenhouse. In a vitro, rooted plants are removed from the culture vessels and agar is washed away completely to remove the potential source of contamination. After the root is formed, that plant, the culture medium, culture vessels removed, and agar is washed away completely to remove the potential source of contamination. Okay, the plantlets are transplanted into the standard pasteurized rooting soil mixture in a small pot or a cells in a more or less conventional manner. Okay, after the removing of agar from that root of the plant, then the plants are planted into the rooting or the soil mixture media. Initially, microplants should be protected from a desiccation in a shaded high humidity temperature and under the mist or fog. Several days may be required for a new functional root to form. Okay. So the micropropagated plants should be protected from desiccation. Desiccation, that means the if the plants are transported from to the lab to the protected cultivation, that is polyhouse, and the desiccation rate, removal of water from that plant is high. So the condition should be maintained like high relative humidity and low temperature. After that, the plants form a new functional root. The plants can be transferred to the main field. The plantlets should be gradually exposed to the lower relative humidity, relative light intensity, any dormancy or a resting condition that develop many may need to overcome as parts of the establishment process. This condition helps in a plantlets in a getting acclimatized to a natural condition, which would help them in getting establishment in the field easily. Okay, after the functional root forms to the plants, the plantlets gradually exposed to the lower intensity, that means the light intensity or the relative humidity low, and the higher light intensity. Okay, light intensity, that means the temperature increase and relative humidity low. So that plant can be established in the field very easily. So this is the process of hardening. Okay. Then culture techniques. Various techniques such as meristem culture, callus culture, shoot regeneration, somatic embryogenesis, ovule culture, embryo culture, mother anther culture, protoplast culture are employed as a micropropagation. This is the different cultures are used in the micropropagation. First is the meristem culture. Meristem culture, it involves the both shoot tip and auxiliary bud of the plant. Okay. Through the meristem culture, we can produce a virus-free plant. The use of small shoot tip comprising apical dome with the one or two leaf primordia, 0.1 to 0.5 mm, is the basis for the techniques known as the meristem tip culture, pioneered by Borel in 1905. Meristem tip culture is now being routinely used mainly horticultural crops for the elimination of virus from the infected material. In meristem culture, we have to use the meristem tip culture, apical bud, auxiliary bud or shoot tip. Mainly, various virus apparently either does not easily invade or rapidly multiply in the young meristematic tissue. A simple nutrient medium consisting only of salt, sucrose, vitamin is used in order to minimize the formation of callus. Gibberellic acid is often needed to promote adequate growth, and NA may be required to stimulate root formation. ओके, दिस इज द डिफरेंट ग्रोथ रेगुलेटर्स आर यूज एज अ प्रोपेगेटिंग मीडिया. ओके, सो द रोल ऑफ ऑक्सिन्स इज टू स्टिमुलेट रूट फॉर्मेशन एंड साइटोकाइनिन इज टू प्रोड्यूस शूट. फॉर द मेकिंग कल्चर वी हैव टू यूज द डिफरेंट सोर्स लाइक साल्ट, सुक्रोज, विटामिन, ग्रोथ रेगुलेटर्स एटसेट्रा. Then callus culture, a piece of sterile plant tissue with living cell is a transfer to culture medium to induce the cell callus proliferation. Okay, first in meristem culture we have use apical bud, auxiliary bud or shoot tip. Yeah? Okay, in the callus culture we have to use a sterile plant tissue with living cells. And the cells are transferred to the culture medium to induce the callus proliferation. Subculturing is then done onto the medium with or without altered growth regulator concentration, ultimately results in the induction of adventitious organ or embryo. In the last stage, regenerated plants are removed from in vitro culture and slowly exposed to the outer environment so that the plants can be fully autotrophic. Okay, after subculturing is done onto the medium with or without altered growth regulators. Okay, then the adventitious roots are formed, adventitious organ or embryos are formed. In the last stage, the regenerated plants are removed into the in vitro culture and then slowly exposed to the outer environment. Then cell culture. The cells are maintained in a suspension culture so as to produce a free cells and are then subculture to regenerate complete plant from a single cell. The technique is now useful to induce the variability in the plant cells and select the desirable cell variants to regenerate complete plants from this variant. In this culture, cells are maintained in a suspension culture. Okay, then the process are same for all the cultures. Then embryo culture, it involves aseptic excision of embryo and it's transferred to the suitable medium for the development under the optimum culture condition. In this case, we have to use embryo. Okay. After the embryo has grown into the plantlets in vitro, it is transferred to sterile soil or vermiculite and grow to maturity in the greenhouse. This technique is useful in the production of interspecific and intergeneric hybrid, which could not be otherwise accomplished, and also in overcoming embryo abortion. Okay, so this is the this method is useful for to produce interspecific and intergeneric hybrid, and also we can overcome the embryo abortion problem in different plants. Okay, then protoplast culture. From the different source, protoplast, the plant without any rigid cellulose wall but with a plasma membrane only allowed to fuse form the somatic hybrid. Protoplast means a plant without any rigid cellulose wall. Okay, but the protoplasma membrane with the plasma membrane and only allowed to fuse form a somatic hybrid. Are cultured in a suitable media to regenerate the cell wall and again cultured in the suitable media for differentiation and morphogenesis. Okay, then anther culture. A culture of anther is a considerable value to breeders as it possible to produce a haploid plant which reveals recessive alleles. Through the anther culture, we can produce a haploid plant. Haploid plant can be used for the production of homozygous diploid and avoiding generation in inbreeding. Added benefit of such as small flowers, prolonged flowering time will be ensured from the use of haploid plants, as they are usually smaller than their diploid counterpart. And being sterile, there will be no pollination induced senescence. Anthriculture has been used in Pelargonium species to eliminate virus, in Lilium species to produce haploid plants, and in Gerbera to obtain a different flower color. So the purpose of anthriculture to produce haploid plants, then to produce colored plants, colored flowers, etc. Okay. Then somatic embryogenesis. The greatest potential for a clonal multiplication is through somatic embryogenesis, where technically a single isolated cell can produce first the embryo, then complete plant. In the somatic embryogenesis, first single isolated cell can produce embryo, first produce embryo, then other complete, then the complete plant. Then somatic embryogenesis and plantlet regeneration has been reported in a various species of horticultural plants by using midrib leaf and stem callus on modified MS basal medium, supplemented with 1 to 2.0 milligram or 240 or 0.25 to 0.50 milligram of IBA. Milligram per
culture medium.
Technology and application of tissue culture method depends upon the selection of proper culture medium which meets the nutritional requirement. This is the how to prepare culture medium. Okay. Nutritional requirement for the culture plants, culture cell or tissue. The basic component of all nutrient media are inorganic salts, carbohydrates, vitamins, growth regulators, agar for a solid medium, and water, etc. So this is the components are required for the nutrient media. Inorganic salt, carbohydrates, vitamins, growth regulators, and agar. And water. Other components including organic nitrogenous compound, organic acids, complex substances can be important but are optional. The organic nutrients required in micro amounts, macro amounts are NPK, calcium, sulfur, and magnesium. The optimum concentration of each nutrient for achieving a maximum growth rate varies considerably. The essential nutrients require micromolar concentration include ferrous, manganese, zinc, boron, copper, and molybdenum. For the preparing culture medium, we have to use some organic and some inorganic compounds. Okay. Then the concentration of inorganic nitrogen in the culture medium varies from 25 to 50, 25 to 50 mm. Nitrate is commonly used in the range from 25 to 50 micromolar, and the amount of ammonium varies between 2 to 20 micromolar. Then potassium is supplied to the range of 20. Higher the and optimum concentration of phosphorus, magnesium, calcium, sulfur for most tissue are 1 to 3 micromole. The standard carbon source is a sucrose and glucose at the concentration of 2 to 3%. The other carbohydrates which have been tested include fructose, lactose, maltose, galactose, starch, but these compounds are generally much inferior to sucrose, glucose, carbon source. The source of carbon is sucrose and glucose. And other carbohydrates like galactose, fructose, maltose, starch, etc., etc. Most media contain inositol. There is no absolute requirement of myo-inositol, but the inclusion of 100 milligram per liter generally improves the tissue growth. Then MS medium is the most popularly used nutrient medium in plant tissue. The nutrient media are supplied with a certain vitamins. There is a absolute requirement 0.1 to 0.4 gram per liter for thymine. The growth is also involved by the addition of nicotinic acids and pyroxidane, sometimes biotin, vitamin 12, folic acid, then choline, chloride, riboflavin, and ascorbic acid are also added to the culture medium depending upon the type of tissue to be cultured. And the pH of the culture medium is an important factor for maintenance of growth for the culture plant tissue. Plant tissue required acidic pH, initially 5.5 to 5.8 is optimum. Okay, so the culture medium, pH of culture medium is acidic, from 5.5 to 5.8. The physical form of culture medium is also an important factor determining the success of failure or of tissue culture. Both liquid and solid form of culture medium are useful for initiation and proliferation of callus tissue and initial organogenesis. But for a further growth of organ, solid medium essential. The culturing in a liquid medium, gentle agitation of the liquid is necessary for aeration of culture medium, and rotating apparatus is used for this purpose. Mainly for the in the micropropagation, a solid medium are used as a media, and if you use the liquid medium, you have to require gentle agitation of the liquid and rotating apparatus for the process of micropropagation. So this is all about micropropagation, different stages, different methods of micropropagation, application, advantages, disadvantages of micropropagation.